Yesterday, I was talking about anticipation and that we say all the time, not we say, you hear in classes, not mine, all the time, don't anticipate the end of the scene, don't anticipate the end of the scene, you know? And I remember being in theater school, people go, don't anticipate the end of the scene, you're anticipating the scene, don't anticipate the end of the scene. And what they mean is they're correct, you shouldn't anticipate the end of the scene, but you don't anticipate the end of the scene is because the actor's in their head and they're self-motivated, they're in the actor brain, they're not in the character brain. And they're in their system two, which is the thinking system. They're not in system one, which is the visceral system. And they're thinking ahead about their lines, or they're thinking ahead about where they need to be, or they. But anticipating the scene, what they're trying to say is you're not in the scene. You're ahead of the scene because you're thinking about what's coming. The actor is thinking about what's coming. And so instead of saying you're anticipating the end of the scene, which again, my metaphor for that is if you go to a medical doctor and you sit down and the doctor says, my, you have a rash. Thank you. Next. That's completely and utterly useless. All I'm going to think about now is that I have a rash. So you're going to be sitting in the scene going, don't anticipate the end of the scene. What does that mean? I'm anticipating. I'm thinking about the scene. I'm anticipating. You know, that's all you're thinking about. That's like a pretty dumbass note. If somebody is anticipating the scene, it's because they're not flowing in the scene. So you have to then assess, it just takes more work for the teacher, but you have to assess, is it because this person doesn't understand the scene well enough? Is it because this person is emotionally not connected to the character and therefore not in the flow of the scene? Or is it because this person is self-conscious and their insecurity system is taking over and their nervous system is shutting down and they're not inside of character? And all three of those are you're not inside of character. And so you need to stop and go, okay, I need to assess what's going on. Now, early actors do that. We don't worry about that. None of you do that. Then what happens is actors they're in the moment and they know to be in the moment and they're present and they're connected and they're just like I'm in the now, which is excellent. Except for that, very few people are like that in the real world. And to remind you, you're actors, so you're playing real people in the real world. Real people in the real world are always anticipating the moment coming, regretting what just happened, and they're thinking in their heads. And so you go, oh shit, now what do I do? So this took a little while for me to figure out, like 20 years ago, but the actor has to be completely clear in their instrument and open and tuned and connected out and charismatically vectored out and outside of their head so that the character can then come in and play whatever the character needs to play. You've got to that position of I'm clear and I'm out. You get these actors who are like moderately good actors. I have an example of Jared Leto doing it moderately okay. And it's an actor who's in the moment and they're connected and they're going and they're playing the script and they're doing it. But there's no connection to what the character is going through. So each moment is seems crystal and beautiful, but in the end you go, I don't know if that's a person. And so I was reminding people yesterday that an actor can't anticipate the end of the scene, but a character always does. A character is always anticipating what's coming. And for one character, it's going to be I have an expectation of what's coming, and then I'm totally surprised. And for one character, it's going to be I'm anticipating what's happening, and damn it happened, and I didn't want it to. Early actor, you go, well, I saw that coming, because they're anticipating the end of the scene. On a mid-range actor, you go, wow, that was really exciting. I didn't see that coming. And that's not good. On a high end, on a little bit better would be, oh yeah, I saw that coming. Oh yeah, that was coming. I saw that coming at the beginning, you know? But a master actor, I didn't see that coming. Then it happens and you go, oh fuck, of course that's what it was going on. That's what it is. It's the spontaneous but inevitable result. It's the surprising but obvious ending. And that's what great acting is. And that's because that's what life is. And I said this yesterday because we all have the same story, and our stories are called life. And each one of us has the exact same last page, which is the end. And we spend all of our lives anticipating the end of our story and then playing against it in denial and doing everything we can to not go there. And that's what characters do. Characters can anticipate the end of this scene and then go shit, right? So the mastery is an actor who is doing their best to not anticipate the end of the scene, fail, and then we end up there. But how does that happen if an actor is supposed to be out of their head and charismatic? And that's what I want to come to really briefly. It's really obvious, but I hope it's like blocking obvious, which is an actor can't think. In my very first acting class in like 1998 or whatever it was, I had this huge sign in my studio that said, "Do, don't think." And I was like, "Don't think," you know, and we would turn off our thinking engines and stuff when I was first teaching. And I was right. It was right. You can't think. An actor can't think. If you're thinking in the scene, and I'm thinking about your dialogue, thinking about the props, thinking about what's my next moment, thinking about the blocking, thinking about, oh my God, New York Times is in the audience. That was awkward, that one. Thinking about my wardrobe's not working, thinking about, you know, you're thinking, the actor thinking. But there's another version of that, which is you're not so much thinking about specifics, but you're in your head and you're thinking. You're thinking about the performance as you go. You're thinking about the character. You're thinking about the actions. And like David said last week, you're thinking about the, what did you call it? The tent poles, the beat switches, you were like the stage managing the moments of the scene. And so what we do is we teach, like I taught George and all of you in this class, we teach and teach and teach and teach you to get out of your heads so that you're not thinking. And there's that glorious, glorious moment when you see an actor for the first time, a bunch of you in this room, who were acting and they went, oh my God, I'm not thinking. That was amazing. What happened? Time's collapsed. The scene's over before it felt like it started. Did I say my dialogue? That was wicked. I wasn't thinking at all. And we push towards that. Like all great acting, it's the best feeling. All great acting is when you've lost control and surrendered. The scene happens just as written, but you're not even in control. And when you're done, you go, you literally, all of your experiences on set should be at cut, good, print, we're moving on. That was scene 14. You walk over to the script supervisor and go, did I say all my dialogue? And she's like, oh, it's usually a she. Like, yeah, oh yeah, you said the dialogue. And they're like, I said all the dialogue? Like, yeah, I'm like, oh, okay. And you're like, what the fuck happened? I wasn't even there. That's what we push actors to. And that's great. But this is a grad class. The exciting acting is not the early actor anticipates or thinks. The good new actor is not anticipating and they're not thinking. It's that the master actor stops thinking and the character starts thinking for them. And you start thinking in character. And when you're thinking in character, now you've hit what is life. And that's when I go, fuck yeah, that's it, you've got it. Ends up at the high level of an actor, once you've taught an actor to stop thinking, you start teaching them how to think as character. And the way to get yourself to not think is to train yourself to be a vectored out actor who can overcome their insecurity system, accept their vulnerability, and then find focus in surrendering to a scene. And then how you overcome that and become the actor who is actually in the thought process is deeply, 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 deeply thinking about the scene. So the answer, I'm setting this whole thing up to tell you something which you already know, which is really obvious, which is week one, scene analysis is 100% insanely important because unlike, so the Meisner School, we were, I think, half of us just probably couldn't, but I would assume that 50% of us got out of our heads and were really charismatic and exciting, but we weren't actors. We were charismatic, exciting people saying the words of Shanley, but we weren't doing Shanley. Because if you're doing Danny, or if you're doing Savage, you need to be inside her thought processes, and those thought processes are the script. And so you're working it all out to understand exactly the tiny minutiae of thinking. Because you can't teach a young piano player to play high-end stuff. You've got to get them to learn how to move their fingers. But at a certain point, I start going, we need to get to the point where you're no longer in control, but it's not just charisma that you're writing. It's the intellectual abilities of the character themselves. That's why we do scene analysis. So I'd like to show you that done well. And I'd like to show you that done poorly. He's there. This is, watch. I could show you, I could show you an actor's acting. Just look up on YouTube any scene and you're going to find 1,000 actors who are incredibly self-conscious. He's not self-conscious. He's other conscious. But he's vacant.
Contestant on television.
What?
I don't know when yet. They haven't told me when yet. But you'll see how proud you are when you see your mother in a red dress.
I find it so
I'm
jarring
a...
in this scene to see a master actor flowing and thinking and connected.
Contestant on television. I don't know when yet. They haven't told me when
that,
yet. But you'll see
it's
how...
like he's not really... They only edited to it because he's blinking, because that gave some movement for them
vision.
To edit.
I don't know when yet. They haven't told me when yet. But you'll see how proud you are when you see your mother in a red dress, television, and golden shoes.
What is the big deal about being on television? Those pills you're taking will kill you before you ever get on, for Christ's sake.
Big deal? You drove up in a cab. Did you see who had the best seat? I'm somebody now, Harry. Everybody likes me. Soon, millions of people will see me and they'll all like me.
That is a charismatic, connected, vectored out, flowing, surrendered actor. She's unbelievable. And her character is going through all sorts of thinking, and she's already anticipating the death of the relationship with her son.
It's a reason to smile. It makes tomorrow all right.
That's an actor who's looking down because he thinks maybe that would be the right thing to do.
Who have I got, Harry? Why should I even make the bed or wash the dishes? I do them. But why should I? I'm alone. Your father's gone. You're gone. I got no one to care for. What have I got, Harry? I'm lonely. I'm old.
God almighty, she's good. Okay, and then there's this stuff. I can't. It's so jarring. In this scene, he's in the average zone. But Jared Leto in this scene is connected and charismatic and very Meisner-y, but he's not nuanced. He's not listening. He's not thinking. He's just being present. And just being present is not enough. That's not what acting is. But if you're showing me the moments and the actor's thinking, then that's not acting at all.
Standing there like that, you remind me of a man who used to come to our house when I was young. My father used to say, "Watch this man." So I did, every time he came. And never once did he do anything remarkable.
And I remind you of him?
This one time, I was about the age of your son. Our house was overrun by partisan border guards. Dozens of them. My father was beaten, my mother was beaten, and this man, my father's friend, he was beaten. And I watched this man. Every time they hit him, he stood back up again. So they hit him harder. Still, he got back to his feet. I think because of this, they stopped the beating. They let him live. Stoiki muzhik. I remember them saying it. Stoiki muzhik. Which sort of means like a standing man. Standing man.
That's how you think on camera. You guys see that? Like, that's how you think on camera. Do you see? You see what? But listen, is Rylance self-conscious? No. Is he in his head? No. Is he present? Yes. Is he in the moment? Yes. Is he connected? Yes. Is he surrendered? Yes. Is he flowing? Jesus Christ, yes. Is he in his head? No. Now, is the character thinking? Completely. Is the character losing himself in his own imagery? Totally. Is the character actually disconnecting and going into himself? Completely. That's what a master actor does. So early actors in your head, like after school actors, I'm out of my head. And then master actors, I'm out of my head. And now I've fallen into the character's head. This is as good as it can possibly get. And he underplays the emotions, but you know that he's suffering. All of his imagery is absolutely exact. There's a three-act structure in his monologue. He's having major realizations, two major realizations. He has his own discoveries in himself. He's connected to Tom Hanks, but he's completely lost in his own
thinking. Remind me of a man who used to come to our house when I was young. Mother used to say, watch this man. So I did, every time he came. And never once did he do anything remarkable.
And I remind you of him?
This one time, I was about the age of your son. Our house was overrun by partisan border guards. Dozens of them. My father was beaten, my mother was beaten, and this man, my father's friend, he was beaten. And I watched this man. Every time they hit him, he stood back up again. So they hit him harder. Still, he got back to his feet. I think because of this, they stopped the beating. They let him live. Stoiki mužik. I remember them saying, stoiki mužik.
See?
Which sort of means like a standing man.
Look at that.
Standing man.
Look at that. Look at that.